Hey everybody, Cargurgurgur here, and this is it, my final review for the entirety of Season 5. A lot of you are probably wondering, why the fuck are you so late on this? And the reason is fairly simple, I've been on vacation. I also needed some time after the season finale to go back to it, binge-watch the whole thing again, so I could make a definitive review of what I thought on the whole thing. Personally, I hate reading reviews about movies and televisions from these major websites because these people are paid to be pretentious dicks, and I can't even stand some of the Game of Thrones YouTubers with their reviews because a lot of them have never read the books, and if they had, they're too stuck up George's asses to enjoy the television show. Despite what some of you may claim, I can enjoy aspects of the television show while also giving a nod to the books. So consider this the most brutally honest and fair review you'll see on YouTube. I promise you that. Now, at the end of the episode 10 review, I said I would be giving out some gift cards to people who could give me the best Adolf Hitler is Jon Snow's father theory. You guys know I'm not a big fan of theories, and I always enjoy taking shots at them. I've read probably over 100 of them, and I chose 3 people who each got $50 gift cards to Amazon. This came out of my pocket, and I always enjoy rewarding people who can be as fucked up as I am. I will be posting my favorite story up on my Facebook page along with the picture that the person made through Photoshop. Quite funny, actually, especially if you grew up in the 90s like I did and watched a lot of Cartoon Network. Now, with that out of the way, let's get on to it. First, we'll start up in the north, and I've gotta say, I'm impressed with how things turned out for many characters. Some were a letdown, but a lot of them did shine. I'm gonna start with Sansa and the Boltons in Winterfell. I will say that it was nice seeing that place again, and it's a welcome change from King's Landing, but I also wish we got to see other places too. Now, some of you may hate me for saying this, but I really enjoyed House Bolton this season. They've got to be my absolute favorite, and I'll tell you why. Roose Bolton's actor does an amazing job in his role that every time he was on screen, you tensed up a bit because he just brings so much gravitas to that character. Ramsay was also amazing, in terms of character portrayal, of course. One of the best things about the Star Wars prequel was Emperor Palpatine and how much fun his actor had in playing that role, and you can tell. I've got to say the same thing about Ian Rowan, if I said his name right. Watching him play Ramsay was great. I read somewhere that he originally auditioned to play Jon Snow, but I really can't imagine him as anybody else. He's just that good. I also want to point out that watching both Ramsay and Jon Snow this season, it really does feel like they're both George Martin's version of Batman and the Joker, with Miranda being Harley Quinn, of course. I love it. But as much as I enjoyed the Boltons, I don't really understand the idea behind Sansa being married to Ramsay. It's way off course with what we're getting in the books, and I understand that they have to remove some things due to time constraints, but I personally feel that Sansa is used as a punching bag way too often, and she's never really had much time to shine. The main hype behind her character at the beginning of the season was that she was this new person who's been taught a couple of things by Baelish himself, but then it turns out that Sansa is right back where she was, being tortured and raped by a psycho. It really doesn't make much sense to me why they would choose to pit her with Ramsay instead of having her play the political game in the Vale with Peter Baelish. The one thing I thought they were going to do is what I would have done, which is to have Sansa and Theon run away and Ramsay find out, he gets pissed and then realizes that they probably went and ran away to Castle Black where Jon is the Lord Commander. Ramsay then writes his infamous pink letter. That would have been a great place to go, but they didn't do that. And see, the direction of some of the characters makes no sense to me, and what they're doing with them also makes no sense. Like Theon and Sansa jumping off the battlements when they could have gone through another location in Winterfell. They do know the place better than the Boltons. But yeah, like I was saying, the Boltons were fantastic, especially Ramsay, but I was not a big fan of the direction they're taking Sansa. I feel as though her story could have been more interesting had she stayed in the Vale with Peter. Theon didn't get much to do this season until the very end, but I did enjoy his performance as well. Alfie Allen is great as always, and I'm a little disappointed we didn't get some of the other Greyjoys, but oh well. Overall, the Boltons, very good. Sansa, meh. Would like to see more Greyjoys. Moving on to my man Stannis. I'll say this now, he's kind of a hard person to put on screen in terms of personality. In a way, he's kind of boring, but there really isn't much to him. Unlike Jaime, who's full of depth, Stannis is a very serious person, and in some ways, he's not too deep in terms of character development. It's tough to put that kind of person on television, but I still feel like they could have given him more screen time and things to do. In Season 3, for example, he barely did anything, which I think is a wasted opportunity, and ever since the end of Season 2, the only thing he's really done is argue with Davos, make these little speeches, and complain. Some fans have said that Stannis' character has been completely ruined by the showrunners, and I wouldn't go that far, but I would say that they could have done a bit more to make us like him, you know? This season, I enjoyed his character in the beginning and in the end. His interactions with Jon Snow and Samwell Tarly were great. His final stand at the battle outside Winterfell was also amazing. It's just that when he leaves Castle Black, there wasn't much there for me in terms of enjoyment. Davos was Davos. He really didn't do much for me to take note of. Melisandre was there. I did enjoy her interactions with Jon Snow too, but I would have loved if she got screen time with Sam. That would have been good considering he knows a lot about random stuff and they could have had some witty banter or something. I will say that they did a shitty job when foreshadowing Shireen's demise. Hell, I was able to call her death a mile away simply because there was an unusual amount of focus on that character that has been around for quite some time. The scenes between her and Stannis and Davos were good, but they should have been done much early in season 3 or 4. My one complaint about Stannis and his group is that Melisandre's visions and powers are still so vague that it's frustrating when she doesn't go into detail. She wants to sacrifice Shireen because something magical will happen. Like what? Oh, that's right, nobody fucking thought to ask her. Hell, I don't even think the showrunners even know much about her powers either. She's been around for 4 seasons now, and all we know is that she loves fire and can give birth to shadow assassins. I'm going to need a bit more detail on this, please. Overall, Stannis went out like a man. His scenes were fairly good, not as great as the Boltons in Winterfell, but I still enjoyed it. I would have liked to see more character development on him and some early on interactions between him and his family to make his decision to burn his daughter more of a desperate and heartbreaking decision, but what's done is done. And before I move on to Jon Snow, let me just touch on Brienne for a moment here. I thought her taking out Stannis was fucking bullshit, but other than that, I really did enjoy her scenes this season. We've got an awesome fight scene between her and some of the Vale Knights, we got backstory and a bit of bonding with Podrick, and we got to move her story a bit further too. Many of you complained that we didn't see much of her, but I like that. She's not one of the top tier main characters of the show, and I like that she didn't get too much screen time that some other pointless characters seem to get. So yeah, Brienne was alright by me this time around. Haven't really been interested in her since season 3. Hopefully they keep her scenes short and to the point. Now on to Castle Black and Jon Snow. To sum it up, I thought it was good. I was not expecting them to kill off Mance Rayder so quickly, but I was okay with it, and I do understand why it was done. This is the television show going off in its own direction, which is fine if it makes sense to me, and it does. The events at the Wall with the election, Stannis correcting people's grammar, and the tension between the Night's Watch and Jon's love for the Wildlings was good, but some of my favorite moments have to have been the conversation between Jon and Maester Aemon, and the Battle of Hardhome. Kit Harington's acting has improved a lot since season 1, and everybody was on point. My one complaint, and I'm sure you all know it's coming, is the abundance of Gilly and Sam. I won't even get into it because I've said it over 500 times already, but get ready for more of that pointless bullshit because now they cast Randall Tarly for next season, and you just know we'll be getting more of this fucking guy. Once again, I don't hate Sam, I just hate how much screen time he gets. Another thing I just want to point out, it's not really a complaint, more like a disappointing turn of events. The 2 new characters we got at the Battle of Hardhome, that Thenn guy and the Wildling woman. Yeah, I actually wanted to see more of them, but then I realized, oh yeah, this is Game of Thrones. Look, I hate to run by this so quickly, but the Night's Watch stuff was alright by me. I found a lot of it entertaining. I just wish they would have used Sansa's escape as a way to shoo in the pink letter. That would have been great, but moving on to hotter conditions in Dorne. And, okay, where to start with this shit? What the fuck happened? You assholes had one job. Don't fuck it up. Not that hard. A lot of it didn't make any sense, like Jaime and Bronn sneaking into Dorne and the shitty payoff at the end. I thought they were going to do a cool twist like Durant was the one who sent the threat to Cersei, or that Cersei made up the threat to get Jaime out of King's Landing so she could do some political maneuvers. But nah, that would have made too much sense for this. What I honestly think happened is that the showrunners Dave and Dan had some intern, probably the same guy who fucked up last year by spoiling it was the Night's King, remember that guy? Yeah, they probably had that guy write the Dornish scenes while they had sex with each other covered in mayonnaise because why not? Why the fuck not? Okay, so I'm not a writer, but here's what I would have done had I been in that writing room. This is my version of Dorne for season 5. Instead of sneaking into Dorne, how about Jaime travels there the normal way to take the head of Gregor Clegane to the Martells? Why? Well, during the trial by combat between him and Oberyn, the Mountain confessed to multiple people in front of, like, a crowd that he had killed Elia Martell and her children. In front of people. Until that point, it had been speculation that the Mountain had done it. In fact, in season 4, Oberyn says that he heard rumors that the Mountain killed Elia. So, with this confirmation, Jaime devises a plan to take his head to Durin with Bronn as a way to make peace with the Martells, to ensure that they don't take Oberyn's death as a reason to go to war or join Stannis. Okay, so we have Jaime going to Dorne with Bronn, and they're carrying the skull of the mountain. Arya Martell, who is Durin's daughter, she overhears her father talking that Jaime is coming, and she rounds up the three Sand Snakes to enact vengeance for her uncle. While Jaime travels around Dorne with Bronn, he learns more about the Dornish culture, and as he learns about it, we, the viewer, also learn about it. On his way to the Water Gardens, he is attacked by the snakes in a variety of ways. For example, Jaime could be staying at an inn in one of the towns, and suddenly dozens of scorpions drop down from a canopy onto him, or, like, as he gets out of the way in time. You know, shit like that. I feel as though this would have been better than the snakes trying to capture a little girl and failing. Once Arianne's plans have been discovered, then maybe we could have had Durin lock her away and then reveal his plans, which may have something to do with the Targaryens. I won't spoil the books, but yeah. They could have done it, but nope. We had to have shitty actresses and terrible lines. Bad pussy, really? You guys must have been high or something, because that is fucking stupid. Also, I've said this multiple times and I'll say it again. Alexander Siddig was a good Durin, but he barely got any screen time. We had a Gilly and Sam sex scene because, of course, but we couldn't have more of this important character for whatever reason. Yeah, I'm convinced that when the showrunners had to read this part in the books, they dozed off. This amount of bad had to have been on purpose. There is no way someone thought this was good. No way. But I'm being a negative Nancy. There was one good part, which was when that one girl got her titties out. Now, if we just had her naked for the entire time, I probably would have enjoyed it a lot more. Just had her naked and give her no lines. Perfect. But overall, Dorne sucked. Moving on. The stuff going on in King's Landing, for a majority of it, I was enjoying, especially when Jonathan Pryce was on screen as the High Sparrow. He was very good, and every time he was on, I paid attention. Lena Headey, as always, was great, and I've got to say this now. When she was doing the Walk of Shame thing, I had to pause and go and pop in my DVD of the movie 300. This will sound bad on my part, but that's only because I'm a weak man, mind you. But when she was naked, I did not even notice it was CGI until some of you guys pointed it out to me. A couple of you got mad at me, too. Carmine, how could you not notice? Look, whenever titties are on screen, I ain't paying that much attention to detail. But yeah, in the movie 300, she had some titties out, and the nipple color is all wrong, and the size is a bit bigger, too. Not that that's a problem. Of course not. I love all boobage, big or small, as long as it's on a female. I had to clarify that. I know a lot of my subscribers very well, you fuckers, don't even try. They mix King's Landing up a bit, but the core of it remained true. Kind of. Some of the religious aspect of what was happening had such perfect timing with what is happening in the States. Cersei tried fucking with religion and it came back to bite her in the ass. I love it. For the most part, everybody was on point. The new Tommen I thought was okay, we didn't see much of him last season, and I thought he did a pretty good job of playing a weak child, especially when he had his scenes with Natalie Dormer. Want to see more of her, please? I will say that King's Landing, as much as I enjoyed it, it did feel a bit lonely without Tywin, Varys, and Peter Baelish. You can only have so much of Cersei at one time, even if her small flashback scene was cool. I'm not saying it was boring, but it didn't have enough of the colorful characters from before to make it even more interesting like it was before, if that makes sense. I did like that they brought back two characters from previous seasons and gave them more to do, and the whole thing with Qyburn and the Zombie Mountain was also good. If I had to nitpick, though, I didn't really like the helmet. In the books, you kind of get the feeling that this new Kingsguard is the mountain, but not really. It's left to us to imagine, based on Martin's description. In the show, they could have made his helmet a bit more ominous and brutal, instead of giving him a modified Kingsguard helmet. But, once again, overall, King's Landing, good stuff. And, okay, so I've noticed that a lot of Game of Thrones YouTubers who reviewed this season did not like Arya in Braavos, which I find a little weird because I absolutely loved her this season. Her journey there was a little ominous and mysterious, which I thought was great. Sure, there was one or two boring moments, but the majority of it was good. You'll always have those book fans who complain over the slightest change, but I did like that it was Meryn Trent who got fucked up. But the one thing I will say that I thought was a mistake was bringing back Jaqen and H'ghar. I said this in my reviews, and after binge-watching Season 5, I stand by it. I think it was a missed opportunity to bring in another character that is just as awesome. I was hoping for an old, kindly man, if you will. But yeah, it felt like a missed opportunity to get a new, more badass person in there, but oh well. And once again, I hate to brush over stuff like this, but I don't have any major complaints. I thought it was good, and I want to see Arya dive deeper into this organization. So overall, I like the Arya storyline, I want to see more of it, and I hope they keep it up next season. And finally, we come to the stuff beyond Braavos and Meereen with Tyrion, Jorah, and Dany's group. Okay, so after coming off a fresh binge watch of Season 5, I still stand by what I said before, that Tyrion and Jorah definitely need a buddy cop movie. I love these guys together. It's mainly because Peter Dinklage brings a lot of life to the part, and whenever he's interacting with other characters, it's always a fun and interesting scene. While Ian Glen plays a great Jorah, the character itself is a bit bland, and Dinklage makes him more enjoyable. I would have liked to have seen Tyrion team up with Daario while they search for Dany next season, but of course that would have been too epic. Also, can we please have more dwarf cock references next season? Seriously, this needs to be a thing. As for Daenerys and her group, I'm a bit disappointed that Barristan got killed off so early on in the show. This is just a complaint from book readers, and it does annoy me a bit too, because we didn't see much of him and Dany talk about Rhaegar and the Targaryen dynasty when he served under her father and grandfather. You guys know me, and I absolutely love when characters talk about the past and the battles they've been in. Hell, one of my favorite scenes in Season 1 was when Jaime tells Robert about how he killed the Mad King. I love stuff like that, and it's a shame we only got a couple of scenes like that since he came back in Season 3. Would have liked more of it, and I also wanted him to go down with more of a body count, too. Grey Worm was also taken out early on, too, but I thought it was a little weird, but I was fine with it. I didn't like his little scenes with Missandei last season, and I'm fine that he wasn't around all that much. Daario is Daario. I have no issue with him. I think the actor does a good job. I do hope we get to see him fight some more next season, though. That I do like when he, you know, throws down. As for Dany herself, Let me ask you guys this, though, before I go into her. Wink. Have you ever noticed how casual fans of the show never refer to her as Daenerys or Dany, but they usually refer to her as the Khaleesi? Has anybody ever noticed this, or is it just people I know? When I say casual fans, I mean people who just watch the show on HBO and that's it. They don't care about the lore, they just want to watch what's on screen. Maybe it's just the people I know, but yeah, let me know below if this is a thing where you guys are at too. But on to the Dragon Fire Lady. So if you saw my previous video, I asked you guys whether or not you think Emilia Clarke is a good actress or not, because I couldn't tell. The reason I can't tell is because this kind of thing has happened before. In the Star Wars prequels, I couldn't tell whether Hayden Christensen, I think that's his name, was a bad actor or just given bad direction. But as for Emilia Clarke, this has been answered for me in a movie known as Terminator Genesis. My god, she was so bleh. And it didn't help that the male lead, Jai Courtney, was also bleh. I got hated on for saying that too. Some feminazis, not feminists, but the extreme version of that, they got on my case because, and I quote, "I can't handle a strong woman in power." Believe me, if you've seen the last three girls that I dated, you would think otherwise. But it's just that I don't think Emilia Clarke is that good. It's weird, in Season 1, I didn't mind her at all that much. Maybe we should get Jason Momoa back in there to fuck her or something, because back then she was good, and now it's like, what the fuck happened? Also, what's with the no nudity clause in her contract? It makes some of her scenes a little weird. Like when she's in bed with Daario, she covers up and it kinda takes you out of believing that these two are in a relationship. I mean, fuck lady, show some nipple or something. We don't need ass or full bush. Maybe a nipple or two to show that you two are actually doing stuff. I will get a lot of hate for saying this, but do you know who I think would have made a good Daenerys Targaryen? 2003 version of Angelina Jolie. Back then, before Brad ruined her life, she would have been a great for the role. She would have been doing some crazy naked backflips or something. I'm getting off track here. Dany had a couple of good scenes this season. I thought her inner awesomeness came out when she fed that one guy to her dragons. That was cool. And I really liked it when she and Tyrion sat down for a conversation. That was great. I also enjoyed the moment when she sees Jorah in the fighting pits and they share this stare. That was also good, but a lot of the times it was eh. The one scene I had a problem with was when Drogon appeared to save them. I thought the scene where she gets on Drogon's back wasn't really well done. For HBO CGI, it's alright, but I really wish they would have shelled out some more cash for that scene so it didn't look like PlayStation 2 graphics. That's just me, but Dany and her group could have been a bit better, but it's still not as worse as Dorne. So, to close up this video, because I'm sure you people have lives and probably hate me by now, I'd give Game of Thrones Season 5 a rating of 4 out of 5, which is higher than what I gave it last season. There were a lot of good parts, but the main issue I had with this season were the lack of development in some areas, pacing, and terrible choices in terms of storyline decisions. The show loves giving characters who are useless more screen time than characters who should be on screen some more. Many of you kept saying that nothing was happening whenever you finished an episode, and that is mainly because a lot of what we saw has been done before, and it all ties in with the lack of development for characters. We were led to believe that Sansa was this smarter, darker person, but it turns out it's a repeat of what's been happening to her since season 2. The decision to cast the Sand Snakes and the whole Dorne storyline was awful, and what I just said about the show not giving crucial characters more screen time, we got no Doran, who was great, but instead more Gilly, which makes no sense, considering her book plotline won't be happening. Despite all these problems, the show is still very entertaining. I enjoyed the increased focus on the Boltons and a better look at Essos with Jorah and Tyrion. I was disappointed that we barely got any Varys or Peter Baelish in this season, but I hope they can make a comeback next time. One of this season's best moments was when characters we were cheering for started to venture into the dark side a little. When Stannis burned his daughter for a blessing, and when Dany fed an innocent man to her dragons. I love stuff like that, when the lines between good and evil are blurred, and that the people who we thought were good guys have some flaws of their own. Jon Snow was doing a good thing by saving those wildlings, but he was a bit stupid when he neglected to consider the blowback that would come from the Night's Watch. But I've spoken for too long. Give me your thoughts on this season, let me know the pros and cons, and what you would like to happen next time. Thanks for watching, and a Baba Booey to you all. Have a good one.